We belong together, Jones. Me, you, poor little skirt.
Have you met Miss Jones? Someone said as we shook hands.
Recently, I rewatched the Bridget Jones trilogy for the God knows how manyth time, and this rewatching had gotten me thinking a lot about the series' fabulously flawed protagonist, Miss Bridget Jones herself. In particular, I have been thinking a lot about Miss Jones's fashion choices and the overall costume design of her character and the films. And I came to the conclusion that the costume design of Bridget Jones, the first film in particular, is truly brilliant. Bridget's fashion choices are a crucial part of her characterization and have a massive impact on the movie's plot. Both of Bridget's love stories, with Mark Darcy and Daniel Cleaver, begin with an interaction about clothing. Mark with his reindeer jumper, and Daniel with Bridget's iconic, much too short for work, miniskirt. Bridget Jones's Diary is a marvel for costume design, because it is a movie where the character's clothing choices directly affect and often dictate the plot. Bridget Jones isn't a movie most people, even people deeply interested in costume design like myself, think of when we think of successful costume design. Often when people think of good costume design, they will think of shows and movies that are inherently about fashion, like Sex and the City, Breakfast at Tiffany's, or The Devil Wears Prada. These shows and movies have had a long-lasting impact on the fashion industry. They have influenced market trends and have stood to define the styles of their era. No one encapsulates 1990s Beverly Hills prep school like the girls of Clueless, or Egyptian beauty like Cleopatra. And we in part have good costume design to attribute these cultural ethos to. But Miss Jones is no Carrie Bradshaw or Cher Horowitz. She isn't a style icon whose fashion sense has influenced generations of people. Bridget Jones's successful costume design is different. The clothes aren't inherently fashionable, but their impact is felt throughout the film. It's raining men! Bridget Jones's Diary is based on a 1996 book of the same name by Helen Fielding. Our protagonist, Bridget Jones, is a 30-something single woman living in London who begins a diary in the hopes of changing her luck in her work and love life. She writes about her career, self-image, vices, family, friends, and romantic relationships in this diary. Bridget's story is very loosely based on Jane Austen's masterpiece, Pride and Prejudice. Bridget meets a man named Mr. Mark Darcy, played by Colin Firth, at a holiday party thrown by her boisterous and often embarrassing mother. When Bridget and Mark first meet, they do not hit it off. They end up having an awkward conversation, and afterwards, Bridget overhears Darcy insult her behind her back. This embarrassing moment is the catalyst that sets Bridget on her path of bettering herself. Bridget works at a publishing company and has a crush on her player, bad boy boss, Daniel Cleaver, played by Hugh Grant. The story follows the plot structure and hits similar plot points to that of Pride and Prejudice, with Bridget being Lizzie Bennet, Mark Darcy being, of course, Mr. Darcy, and Daniel being the equivalent of Mr. Wickham. The costume design of Bridget Jones helps to reinforce that, like Elizabeth and Mr. Darcy, Bridget and Mark are not on the same class level. Bridget always looks a bit of a mess. Her clothes often don't fit right and are often inappropriate for the setting she is in. This signals her lower status. Status in Bridget Jones has to do with traditional maturity, meaning that Bridget is basically a 22-year-old in the body of a 32-year-old.
Mark.
So childish.
Where Mark, by contrast, is a lawyer, often seen in crisp suits and perfect Ralph Lauren-style sweaters, showing him to be a full-fledged and classy adult. These costume choices help to set up the base of their relationship, that they are two very different people in very different stages of their lives. Bridget Jones is inherently unfashionable. She struggles throughout the first two movies to get dressed on multiple occasions, always looking for guidance from her more fashionable friends or from complete strangers.
It's a lot worse than I thought, Bridge.
We could try flapping it down with Brill Cream.
What about a wig? They're lawyers, aren't they? Lawyers love wigs.
I prefer to win the gold.
No, whatever you do, definitely not the...
But there's something deeply likable about Bridget and her style. Bridget is relatable, and she speaks a level of truth to her primarily female audience in ways most rom-com protagonists do not. The reason I continue coming back to these movies is not just because I love seeing Hugh Grant and Colin Firth get wet and fight with one another. It's because Bridget is one of the most likable fictional characters ever created. Bridget is not supposed to be seen as cool, posh, or hip. She's a real person who gets in trouble and stains her clothes in the process. We as the audience might overlook Bridget as a style icon because she is not supposed to be one. And in this analysis, I'm not making a case for that. I am, however, making a case for how this movie understands the art of costume design and displays the power it can have on a film's characters and how costume design can be used to move plot. Bridget's and other characters' clothes are used as catalysts for multiple arcs throughout the films, and are used as running gags throughout the trilogy. The first example of this is our introduction to Mark Darcy, where Bridget is taken aback by his hideous reindeer jumper, and he is taken aback by the matronly and carpet-like outfit that Bridget's mother makes her wear. These clothing choices directly add to the tension of their first meeting, and to their disdain for one another. Darcy insults Bridget by commenting on her bad habits and her outfit.
Mother, I do not need a blind date, particularly not with some verbally incontinent spinster who smokes like a chimney, drinks like a fish, and dresses like her mother.
Being seen wearing ugly clothes is part of the reason Bridget is pushed on her venture of bettering herself in the first place. This interaction is referenced back to multiple times in the first movie, including when Darcy confesses his interest in Bridget.
I realized that when I met you at the turkey curry buffet that I was unforgivably rude and wearing a reindeer jumper.
And when we see Mark again at his parents' Christmas party a year later, sporting an equally embarrassing snowman tie. The sweater comes back up again in the second film's opening, when Mark and Bridget are seen wearing coordinating ugly Christmas sweaters, showing that they are now together and are in sync and are on the same playing field. One of Bridget's staple pieces is the miniskirt. Bridget has a bit of a habit of wearing inappropriately short skirts and other ill-suited items of clothing for the average workplace in 2001.
Afternoon, Bridget. What do you mean you're going on?
The miniskirt acts as the fire starter of her flirtation with her boss, Daniel Cleaver. Daniel writes patronizing emails to Bridget saying that her skirt is missing and must be out sick, pushing the start of their non-professional interactions and sexual relationship.
Message, Mr. Cleaver. I'm appalled by message. Skirt is demonstrably neither sick nor absent.
The issue of Mrs. Jones's miniskirts is carried throughout multiple scenes in the first two movies, even becoming part of the reason she is held back and then succeeds at her various jobs.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Okay, we're out of time. Just wind her up.
Seems to be about all we've got time for down here in Lewisham.
Because Bridget wears a miniskirt, her bum is shown on live television, which leads her to become a popular reporter at Sit Up Britain, which leads her back to Mark Darcy at the trial. Her clothing choices are directly affecting the plot. One of Bridget's most cringeworthy mishaps is when she dresses unfortunately appropriate for her aunt's Tarts and Vickers party that, of course, ends up getting canned last minute in favor of a classic garden party. Miss Jones shows up horrified in full Playboy Bunny attire, floppy ears and all, to learn that she and a handful of other unlucky guests did not get the memo about the party's theme change. This scene helps to reinforce the awkward tension between Mark and Bridget, having them so blatantly contrasted and making Bridget feel like a complete clown in a public setting.
Bizarre what some men find attractive.
Mark sympathizes with Bridget in this moment, realizing that not all of her misgivings are inherently her fault. The awkward misdirection of the party's theme also helps to emphasize Bridget's close relationship with her father. Both of them are dressed according to the original theme, and this is a very obvious visual representation of how these two characters are outsiders and are seen as comedic in comparison to everyone else at the party. Arguably the most infamous example of the movie using clothing to drive its relationships and character is with Daniel Cleaver and his love of, and constant mocking of, Bridget's large grandma-style panties in the first two films.
For me, absolutely enormous panties.
No, don't apologize, I like them. Hello, mummy.
My favorite scene in the first movie, and one of my favorite scenes in rom-com history, is when Bridget is getting ready for the book party and is struggling to decide whether to wear a pair of sexy, lace black panties that will look hot if her and Daniel sleep together, or a pair of large grandma panties that will suck in her stomach, making her look better in the dress, and therefore will make Daniel more interested in sleeping with her in the first place. Bridget's inevitable choice of the grandma panties ends up being the right one. At the book launch party, Daniel does comment about how good she looks in her dress, and they do end up sleeping together. And the grandma panties come back to haunt Bridget in the second movie, when she is wearing them yet again to another dinner and hookup with Daniel. And the panties act as a bonding source for the pair.
Oh God, I hope you're wearing those giant panties. Please. Please be wearing the giant panties. Please. Oh, my old friends. Oh, daddy's home.
These scenes are just a few of many that center around a clothing item being the catalyst of comedy and romantic relationships. The panty dilemma also adds to Bridget's relatability, as this is a decision many women have contemplated when going on dates. I also personally love that large grandma panties have become a staple with Bridget's character. I think they really reflect her as a person, always trying to look like she has herself together more on the outside than she really does on the inside.
The most important thing, of course, is to look absolutely wonderful and make a magnificent entrance.
Another staple piece of Bridget's wardrobe that isn't really touched upon in the series, but if you are a person who cares about costume design and fashion in general, you would have noticed, is Bridget's Tiffany heart necklace. This is definitely the staple piece of her wardrobe. She is seen wearing it in almost every single scene of the first two movies. For some context, the necklace is one of the cheapest necklaces available on Tiffany & Co.'s website, coming in at $225. Tiffany's, for those who do not know, is an extremely luxurious jewelry brand that is highly praised for being classical and posh. It was also the it jewelry brand during the time of these movies. These characteristics of the Tiffany brand are in direct contrast to Bridget as a character. But this dichotomy perfectly reflects Bridget at the time of these films. She is a flawed woman who wants to be seen as effervescent and high class, but she can't because that's inherently not part of who she is.
Oh God, I'm very worried. What if someone says, Bridget Jones, get out of here. You are ridiculous.
This necklace is an aspirational item. It is in the shape of a heart, which of course in a romantic comedy is supposed to reinforce the idea that Bridget cares deeply about finding love and romance in her life. Second, the necklace represents a version of Bridget that she hopes she can achieve, a posh and classic woman who can afford to shop at Tiffany & Co.
Suddenly feel like screen goddess and Manner of Grace Kelly.
And by wearing this necklace, we get an idea of where Bridget wants to be in the future. I like the idea that Bridget bought this necklace during a time of her life that is similar to the one we see her in at the beginning of the movie. A time of getting my shit together. A time when Bridget was working hard and saved enough money to get herself a Tiffany necklace, which would mean that she was on her way to becoming a more adult and polished version of herself. Bridget Jones's Diary should not only be seen as a phenomenal romantic comedy, starring a woman with real flaws and truly female issues, but also as a film that understands the power of clothing. If life is a rom-com, then the clothing we wear is the costumes. And Bridget Jones's Diary will tell us that the clothes we wear every day have great effects on our lives. They can help us get promoted or demoted, can help with our personal confidence, and can even help us snag a top barrister boyfriend who rocks reindeer-themed sweaters and likes us just the way we are, a real Mr. Darcy of our own. The best is yet to come.